I would like to call on stage the session chair, Ramit Arora, COO and Head of Digital Brands, HD Digital Stream, on stage. Would also like to request a panelist to please join us on stage, Anika Agarwal, Senior Vice President and Head Marketing, Digital and Direct Sales, Max Popa Health Insurance, Moksh Chopra, Chief Marketing Officer, KFC India, Ratika Bhargava, Sales and Marketing Head, Kama Ayurveda, Pradeep Gairola, Business Head, Digital Media, The Hindu Group, to please join us on stage. And before we proceed, and the applause, my friend, that just keeps on going as... All right, over to you, Mr. Arora.
Does this mic work? Okay, we're missing one person. That's Ratika. Okay, so on behalf of the panel, first, thank you for having us here. I know this is the first panel of the day, so there's the onerous responsibility of keeping everybody engaged. Quickly jumping to the topic, content and content marketing. We met a little while ago, and a large part of our conversation started with content is what we do every day as consumers. Each one of us is consuming copious amounts of content about our lives, our friends' lives, the world, and brands. And you flip it over to where the brand's gazing at the customer, that's us, and you know, a large part of the brand's life is now spent in creating, managing, and disseminating content that's either been created by them or created for them. And in the age of the internet, the possibilities and the ways in which content can be created are just so many that there's very few excuses to either not inform or educate or entertain or engage. In that light, we'll start very quickly, and I'm going to start with you, Anika. Is content marketing actually a thing anymore? Because isn't marketing content? So, you know, we've always thought of content marketing as a discipline in marketing, but that's really now passé.
Sure. So I think today you have a Google search bar because you have so much content to browse. And when we look at content, I think content is a commitment. It's not really a campaign. And it's a core part of any brand strategy today. We've been creating content for a lot of time. But I think what's happened and what's changed in today's world is that... you know, content now has a history. So, you know, if you're there out there on the net, it's there forever. So I think there's a little more responsibility towards the content you create. The question of discoverability, of saying, you know, you used to create a lot of content as a brand, but then you had to spend an equal amount or more money in disseminating that content. But today you have options of discoverability. So content becomes core. So I think what's important is that content is actually the core of brand strategy. It's not a specific vertical or function, so I think it's actually the largest responsibility of the CMO today, because when you talk about the brand purpose and the brand voice, that's actually you know, signed off from, you know, whatever content is out there on you. So that's what I think, you know, that's the role of content in that sense.
Pradeep, content marketing is not new. All our lives, we've done content marketing. Even when we were doing direct mailers 20 years ago and posting them to people with stamps on the envelope, it is content marketing. Yeah. So what's changed?
So see, I can provide a brand solution provider's perspective, right? So see, in 1995 was when first time I actually delved into content marketing. And this was the time when National Leadership Survey, which was the predecessor of Indian Leadership Survey, was released. And one of the newspaper brands did really well, but that was not reflected in the way they attracted advertising from clients and agencies. See, we provided a solution, a content marketing, a large format, full page advertising, content, which basically analyzed the National Leadership Survey finding for the brand, how it works, and so on and so forth. A few weeks later, a client called us very happy because the ROI was very high, and ROI was what? Some people called him, some his sales force was happy, some agency guy said good thing, and life was simple. Fast forward 2018, a supplement, a nutritional brand or a supplement brand wants to aim children, and there's a lot of thing these days about natural products, right? So, and there's a lot of natural superfoods and all that, and they want to associate, and that's what they asked us a solution. We provide a 3-month, you know, we say that, okay, 3-month activity, 15 odd articles, there is a video, there are various social media posts, now this content is suddenly, you see the dimension has changed. It is no longer a uni-dimension newspaper content kind of a format. So there is a, so many formats suddenly jump into it, but it doesn't, after that, but the client is also very smart, because he says that, okay, we tell him that, see, first month, let's not even talk about your brand, and he's perfectly fine. So in first month, we release a lot of articles where we talk about that, what is, how these various foods available in the nature are so useful, so on and so forth. 1 month down the line, the brand is introduced, right? But before even all this activity started, the ROI is established in terms of that you will deliver us 2 million users who will minimum spend 2 minutes on the content, seeing the content. 80% of them are women, okay? So if you see these dimensions, they are dramatically changed. And the another part is storytelling. So like in the 1995 world, there was a, you just communicated. Now here you are interacting. Even though when experts write the blogs, they have to answer to the people. There are various stories. Mothers are sharing stories. So there's a lot of story element which builds into it. So the content market, in my opinion, has evolved a lot from a one unidimensional, lot of faith-based thing that, okay, we all believe this will work, let's release one full page ad in a business paper and so on and so forth, to now actual deliverables, that measurable deliverables, and if you don't deliver, there is a penalty or a reward. So this is, I think, a lot of thing has changed in the last 2 decades. This is what my perspective would be about.
I'm just going to stick with measurement for 1 minute, and I'm going to ask a couple of you about measurement, because that's a large part of content, right? We tend to think of content as soft, as creativity, but there's two other pieces to it. One is the science, and the other is the measurement. I'm going to start with measurement, and then we'll talk about a little more about the science and where creative and science sort of meet. Anika, you come from a category which is hard-nosed numbers. Like, I know what those numbers look like at the end of every day. And yet, the brand relies more and more and more on content. How do you marry measurement with the creativity of content marketing? And is it even measurable?
Of course, why not? Because if you look at the category, yes, we are, you know, financial services as a category is very measurement and number driven. But if you look at the way any brand would be built today, there'll be two aspects. So there's, of course, the storytelling aspect of it, which is weaved in. But when you look at the science and you look at the measurement, when you define your consumer personas, and that's traditional marketing science, it's nothing new, right? When you define your consumer personas and you say that this is the guy I wish to speak to, and then you create engaging content. Yes, we measure it, and we measure it, you know, across the customer journey. So there's a large part around attracting new customers. And when you attract new customers to a category like insurance, where there's so much mistrust, there's a large part around measurement, but there's also a large part around storytelling. And when we talk about the content ecosystem, we do a lot of, the question is good content, scaled up content, how much content can you today create? Because you talk about personalization, when we generate our leads, you know, you say, I'm going to talk to Ramnik differently, I'm going to talk to Moksh differently, and you know, maybe my content resonates because I've created the right persona, but that's also expensive, right? So I think there is measurability, because right from the journey, when you say that, you know, I'm going to attract, how do you really create content that is, you know, from an ROI perspective, it stacks up. So we've used a lot of things, we've used a lot of ecosystem and partnerships and collaboration. See, unlike, you know, some of you, we're not really content hubs as brands. We do it as a brand. So, you know, you collaborate with the right set of people. Of course, you know, having your right checks and balances and authenticity in mind. But I think collaboration and creating an ecosystem for getting the right content for your consumers is a big driver for us when we say that we want ROI-driven or acquisition-led content. When we look at our customers, we sell a promise in insurance. So when you sell a promise to customers in insurance, There's a customer who's paying you for 10 years and probably not getting anything back. So for us, across the customer journey, how do you really engage with this guy for 10 years? And how do you ensure that you create value and a conversation and an affinity to the brand is actually the real ROI for us as well. So yeah, while it may seem all numbers driven and ROI and, you know, aaj ye content dala, so you know, what's the cost per lead and how many leads did I get today? But there's also the long tail of it, which is why we invest a lot in technology as well when we talk about content and content strategy of saying, you know, how do you measure? How do you ensure that your content is omnichannel and you're, you know, putting it at the right places? How do you ensure you deliver content through the right mediums? So, you know, if I'm talking to my customer through various channels, what's the right one for you and what's the right one for him? So we deploy all those tools when we talk about our content strategy and pieces so that we get some ROI out of it. So ROI is just not cost per lead in that sense for the category.
Okay, so I have two questions coming out of there. Omnichannel is what I'm going to pick on, but good points on tracking customer journeys and the use of technology. Ratika, there is the offline world, there is the online world, there is so much on the online world. There are different audiences doing different things and in different mindsets through the day, and all of them may be customers. How much content can somebody create and how do you manage the complexity of omni-channel in a world where, you know, Anika said the word personalization twice, but everybody is expecting to get what they want, the content that they want when they want it.
So first of all, good evening, everyone. I hope all of you are marketeers, otherwise this would be a very boring session for you. But so I work with a company called Kama Ayurveda, and in a unique position, I look after sales and marketing. So in fact, when we were discussing before this session, we said, let's put in a little bit about omni-channel over here. And to the question asked, content is not omni-channel. Customer is. It's the customer that is going across the channels and participating in your brand and not your content. We are just tailor-making the content to the channel where the customer is participating. And for a company like ours, which is a luxury brand, we have adopted certain channels and bucketed them as per our targets or KPIs. So there are two or three buckets that drive our sales, and there are two or three buckets that drive our brand and our engagement. So for example, Facebook is used for engagement, conversions. Instagram is used for content, storytelling, brand messaging. Then in-store is used for direct customer interaction, engagement, and again, product sales. And that's really how we have adopted the omni-channel into content and content into omni-channel strategy. It's not easy, and I'll give you a small example. We have products that are Ayurvedic, authentic, and some of them appeal to people as young as like 16, 17-year-olds who have acne on their skin. Some of the products appeal to somebody who wants to maintain their skin, you know, maybe 35, 40 years old, anti-aging. Now imagine you have that one Instagram, and on top of that you have a sales target for the month. On top of that you have a holy festival. On top of that you have elections. Then you have summer weather. Then you have the need of the brand to start telling the story about a new product that they're going to launch. And that's when a marketer suddenly figures out that I'm omnichannel. I have lots of content to put out. I have lots of customer audiences to talk to. What do I choose? In a nutshell, decide which content bucket is giving you what return for which customer segment and go with that. So if your stores are going to give you the sales, which they are, online or offline stores, tailor make the content for that. If your Instagram is about storytelling and about building the brand experience, go with that. To your last question, then you don't expect an ROI on that, right? Then you just expect customer engagement, and maybe at some point in time you might have a conversion, but that doesn't become the KPI. So I guess in today's world, I'll just sum it up. Omnichannel is something we all talk about, but we all are, we ourselves are customers. We are omnichannel ourselves. So just tailor make your content to your customer audience and where they are participating.
I'm going to take a track back from what you said. Everything's not about return on investment in terms of cash. Moksh, is there a bunch of metrics that you've evolved that measures engagement, cash ROI, depending on where you are or who you're talking to? Have you been able to evolve metric for content marketing?
I would actually echo Ratika on that. I think, I think there are three streams of content that we create as a brand. I would say, A, the first stream of content is the brand as a publisher. That's one whole stream of content that comes out. The second stream would be the experts as publishers of content. So experts would mean bloggers, critics, reviewers, and they are themselves creating content for the brand. The third stream, I would say, would be consumers as publishers and content creators. So from our perspective, there are three brackets of content that come out from a brand perspective. And I feel from our learning curve, each of them work for different kind of objectives, and each of them have a different measurement metric. Let me start with, say, a brand as a publisher, right? So the most expected thing from us is to share information about the new products we've launched, the new offers that have come out, and we advertise it. I wouldn't count that as content. That doesn't count as brand as publisher. I think, basically, to me, content is where consumers are actively seeking you out, engaging with you more actively, and that really qualifies as content marketing. So if I leave advertising out, what kind of content does a brand like us come up with? So I'll give you an example. Some time ago, we launched a product called, it's a meal box that we launched. The pre-launch component of the meal box was basically an omni-channel multiplayer game that we created. And it was kind of launched 5 days before the launch, the game itself. And we got lakhs of consumers to come on and try and crack the code to unlock this thing called the mystery box. So when we had these 5 days of engagement with consumers, I would consider that to be an example of content marketing where people came on the website, they interacted with the game, tried to crack a code, win something. And interestingly, when they won, they got a VIP access to come to the restaurant and access that box 1 day before its launch. And our measure for that kind of content was how many people actually turned up. And we found that almost, I can't exactly share the number, but about 4% of our sales revenue got met on that one single day before the launch. Because what we were doing is rather than having a pre-launch teaser campaign or having a coming soon campaign or just an advertisement, we created this game where people had to unlock the mystery box. And that gave us revenue that we could actually measure even before the product got launched. So in this example, we actually could define sales itself to measure how this content marketing has worked. But there would be other streams of content, right? Everything isn't about launching new products or offers. So there are often disruptive things we do. Like, so for example, last year we launched something called a KFO, which is a Kentucky Flying Object. It basically means we got people were delivered a box at home that kind of could be reassembled into a drone. And it also, of course, had food in it when the box got delivered. Now, in this kind of content, I think what happens is the news itself is highly disruptive. Or a product like Chizza, for example. The news is highly disruptive. We don't really have to create content there. What we do is we give out the information, the key selling points or the key attributes of the concept that are interesting. And then it has to be handed over and let loose to the native content creators, the platform, the scoop whoops of the world, or other examples that we had used last time. So I would say when we use content marketing and let it out to platforms to create, even bloggers, for example, we have to let go in terms of the style of content that is created. All we have to tell them is, hey guys, something really wacky and interesting coming from a brand perspective. Are you interested? And what we find is our metric there that reflects whether something has actually become successful or not is actually earned media. And we're able to actually track earned media and determine, we find that when things are actually fundamentally interesting for the consumer beyond advertising, earned media kind of flies through the roof. We don't really have to spend much money on it. Everyone's interested, people are sharing it, and we really find ROI actually there becomes, it's going to be exponential. So the measurement of ROI is irrelevant actually. So that's the other interesting thing. What we also can do on the second series of initiatives is that we find that when we do some of these disruptive initiatives like a KFO or a Chizza launch and earned impressions go up, we also see that for that particular quarter, you find an increase in, for example, metrics like top of mind. And we also have found a correlation between top of mind revenue, top of mind and sales revenue itself. So it's a derived metric, but you can actually draw correlations very comfortably from any of the content marketing streams you do, which are big enough to have an impact on earned media. And you can see whether it's made a mark or not. Even consumers actually recall some of these initiatives back to you on a post-brand track. But you must measure that because everything must either drive perception or behavior. If it doesn't drive either of the two, then it's actually a failed initiative. So one of the two has to be tracked for everything. The third one that I'll talk about is consumers as publishers. You know, for example, you know, that's really great fun because you give consumers something to work with. You give them a template. Like we recently told consumers, hey, how many different ways can you say finger licking good? And they come up with wacky, cool content in terms of how they can say it. And we give them a template to work out of. And what we find is engagement rates is a good metric to work on these kind of campaigns. So we find engagement rates to north of 20 to 25% happening on these kind of campaigns, whereas you just take a typical post or an offer, it'll be 1 or 2%. So here you would certainly check for aspects like engagement rate, and that itself is a good check of ROI because there's nothing you're really selling. All you're doing is getting the consumer not to buy your brand, but buy into your brand. And if you can check that with engagement rate, that kind of works beautifully. So,
see, on ROI, one more thing, you know, like which I feel is the if you can make a really interesting content. So one of the examples which I love is this Blendtec, right? Very boring industrial category. You go to his YouTube page, 9 lakh followers. So when the first iPad comes, he has one simple line, can it blend it? And then he puts that entire iPad into his blender and just converts into a dust and generates 18 million views on one video. Now, if you look at the ROI on this kind of a thing, let's say that a person was buying one video view on YouTube at 1 rupee. So till for a 160,000 rupees worth of iPad, his return is 18 million rupees already happened just on this, and the sales are all additional. So an interesting content can actually create a way more ROI, but emotion is something where it starts and rational gets delivered. So this link between emotion and rational thing is something which is a very large challenge a marketer needs to solve.
So we don't always create our own content. There is earned media, but and you know there are so many successful case studies of user-generated content as earned media. Lego's created a whole franchise out of people who create out of Lego and are on YouTube. But that can go wrong as well. Anika, I know there's a lot of misinformation in your category, and people create all kinds of content. And there is the flip side to earned media, which is the wrong type of earned media. What's the strategy to fight that content or misinformation? Is content the antidote to bad content?
So yes, you know, in all categories today, as he said, you know, the consumer is the publisher. So you will have it across. And one comment, one content piece can actually wipe off the entire earned media that the brand has. So I think a couple of things. One, tracking it real time as much as you can across assets, responding real time to them. In our category specifically, I mean, we cannot use technology to do that. We use people to do that. And, you know, because word of mouth is such a big deal, you also have a lot of advocates around. But in category like ours, they're difficult to find. So somewhere we also nudge and nurture those and actually get user content and micro-influencer content out. So that helps.
Okay. We've got 5 minutes, so we're going to go into closing comments. Why don't you start and why don't we go backwards? Closing comments, what is it that you would like to leave everybody here with? The one thing you'd like to take out of your stable and give back to the community on content marketing?
I think I would just say that we've talked a lot about, you know, what we do as brands to manage content. Just one thing that, you know, if we all talk about purpose-led marketing, and, you know, as marketers, that's in our brand strategy all the time. Content gives you a large play around that. And if everything is linked to that one purpose and everything ties back together, then, you know, that's the real sort of impact on top of your funnel. Otherwise, it's just engagement. It's just cost per lead. So I think that becomes very important. And on a lighter note, I think brands as publishers over the years will only go down. So I read somewhere, you know, a quote from one of the guys at Marriott who manages content marketing, who said that, you know, content marketing is like a first date. If you talk too much about yourself, there's never a second date. So I guess we should also let, you know, just let it be sometimes and just be on the sidelines and manage. So yeah.
Okay, very quickly, just one word, credentialing. Whatever content we put out there and you'll put out there, just make sure that it goes back to the brand's authenticity. And whatever the content is, if it comes back to the brand's authenticity and the brand umbrella, you've credentialed your brand and your content will speak 1,000 words. So.
And content has longevity now, so it stays and forever.
Yeah, we'll create longevity long after we are gone.
I think whatever we are seeing in content marketing is just the starting point. Unlike newspaper, television, radio, internet was never created as a mass medium. It was a one-to-one medium. And while Cambridge Analytica influencing 87 million voters in US might be a wrong way of using the power of this one-to-one communication, but that's the future. The future is that it's going to change dramatically. Whatever we are saying today is not going to remain, so we all need to prepare for it. And ultimate power of the medium will be that one unique unique communication for each of the user. That is what a medium is capable to deliver.
So I think my view is that, you know, advertising and content both have roles. Consumers want information from brands as well. They just don't want to be entertained by brands. In fact, they've got enough other folks trying to entertain them who perhaps are a bit better than what brands can do in terms of content entertainment. So, you know, the thing is to be realistic about what your role is and in the space of content, and do it to, again, Ratika's point, do it in a relevant way. You don't have to go out there and have an opinion on everything under the sun, because it's really not required. But it talks back to your brand story. So essentially, I would say content streams should be of two types. Either it talks about what you do as a brand, and talks, or it's done in a way which reflects how you say it, which is your brand story or brand personality. If both of those come alive through content, it's great to do. If it's not working out for that, just let it go. So that's the way I would summarize.
Be authentic, be relevant, invest in technology, don't be afraid to measure, and personalize. I mean, those are the five things that I picked up from you guys. I'm just sort of summarizing, and our time's over. So thank you very much. That was a very efficient discussion and lots of fantastic stuff. Thank you.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.